No, no, no. right now. I know you can. Yes, you can. I believe you can. I believe you can. Do it for me.
Do it for me.
Yeah, 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 yeah. Right now. Right now.
Well, come on and put your hands together and give the Lord a hand clap of praise. You can do better than that. How many of you need the Lord to do it for you? How many of us really need the Lord to do something for us? How many of us want Him to do it right now? Hallelujah. Let us thank God for our praise team. Thank you, Brother Chris. Yeah. I just thank the Lord because that old stuff never leaves you. That's what brought me through. And I was driving the other morning and I had to pull over on the side of the road when it came on. And it just wouldn't leave my spirit. And I called Brother Chris about it and he told me he could do something with it, and I thank Him for it. It's a blessing to be in the house of the Lord one more time. Amen. I thank the Lord for my life today. I thank the Lord for saving me and setting me free and filling me with His Holy Spirit and giving me a life today that is worth living. Hallelujah. Thank Him for the angel of this house, our Pastor Webb. Can we thank God for him? Yeah, that's my friend. That's my confidant. That's my smoker who smokes ribs, my carpenter. He's a good friend, and I thank God for him and his precious wife, our First Lady, Sister Lydia Webb. Let us thank God for her. And for the woman who stands by my side, thank God for my wife, Sister Alicia Wilkerson. Bless you. Thank you. And to all the ministers that are here this morning and all the church family, God bless you. Thank you for being here on this morning. I really do believe I have a word from the Lord today. And I believe that Pastor Webb has consecrated this word this morning through the way he prayed. That was confirmation that this is the word that God wants me to share with you on this morning. If you have your Bibles, if you would, please turn with me to the Gospel of St. Luke, chapter number 4. That's the Gospel of St. Luke, chapter number 4. I'm going to do some extensive reading this morning. It's somewhat difficult for me to move into the direction that the Lord is leading me without me first expounding in the Gospel of St. Mark, chapter 4. And I will fall down into the gospel, the same gospel in chapter 5. So it's the Gospel of St. Mark 4 and 5 we will be in. And I'll begin reading in chapter 4, verses 35 to 41. When you're there, say amen. Again, for those that are still turning pages, that is the Gospel of St. Mark chapter 4. Verses 35 to 41, and I'm going to drop down into chapter 5 of the same chapter. You there, say amen. I'll read in your hearing. And the same day when the evening was come, he said unto them, let us pass over unto the other side of the sea. And when they had sent away the multitude, they took him even as he was in the ship. And there were also with him other little ships. And there arose a great storm of wind, and the waves beat into the ship so that it was now full. And he was in the hinder part of the ship asleep on a pillow. And they awake and said unto him, Master, carest thou not that we perish? And he arose and rebuked the wind and said to the sea, peace, be still. And the wind ceased. There was a great calm. And he said unto them, why are ye so fearful? How is it that ye have no faith? And they feared exceedingly and said one to another, what manner of man is this, that even the wind and sea obey him? Can you say amen? Amen. Chapter 5. And they came over unto the other side of the sea, into the country of the Gadarenes. And when he was come out of the boat of the ship, immediately there met him out of the tombs a man with an unclean spirit, who had his dwelling among the tombs. And no man could bind him, no, not with chains, because he had been often bound with fetters and chains, and the chains had been plucked asunder by him, and the fetters broken in pieces. Neither could any man tame him. And always night and day he was in the mountains and in the tombs, crying and cutting himself with stones. But when he saw Jesus afar off, he ran and worshiped him and cried with a loud voice and said, what have I to do with thee, Jesus, thou Son of the Most High God? I adjure thee by God that thou torment me not. For he said unto him, come out of the man, thou unclean spirit. And he asked him, what is thy name? And he answered, saying, my name is Legion, for we are many. And he besought him much that he would not send them away out of the country. Now there was there nigh unto the mountains a great herd of swine feeding. And all the devils besought him, saying, send us into the swine, that we may enter into them. And forthwith Jesus gave them leave. And the unclean spirits went out and entered into the swine. And the herd ran violently down a steep place into the sea. And they were about 2,000 and were choked in the sea. And they that fed the swine fled and told it in the city and in the country. And they went out to see what it was that was done. And when they come to Jesus and see him that was possessed with the devil and had the legion sitting and clothed and in his right mind, and they were afraid. And they went and saw it and told it how it befell them that was possessed with the devil, and also concerning the swine. And they began to pray him that he would depart out of their coast. And when he was come into the ship, he that had been possessed with the devil prayed him that he might be with him. Albeit Jesus suffered him not, but said unto him, go home to your friends and tell them how great things the Lord have done for thee and have had compassion on thee. And he departed and began to publish in Decapolis how great things Jesus had done for him. And all men did marvel. Can you say amen? Amen. And when he was come out of the ship, immediately there met him out of the tombs a man with an unclean spirit. I'm going to talk a little bit this morning from the subject, help is on the way. Look over at somebody standing next to you and tell them, help is on the way. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. Eternal God, we thank you this morning for your goodness. We thank you, Lord, for your tender mercy. And Lord, I just pray now, Lord, in the name of Jesus, that you would bless us individually and collectively. I pray that, Lord, what you have shared with me in private, we will make public. Help me to decrease, that you may increase. Sanctify your word right now. Move me out of the way. Have your way in this place. In Jesus' precious name, amen. The disciples that Jesus handpicked to become the apostolic bishopry of the church were ordinary men that God would use in an extraordinary manner. Among the 12 he chose were a fisherman, a tax collector, a doctor, and a revolutionary. Jesus didn't choose these men because they were smart or articulate or highly intelligent. He chose them because they were everyday people who had struggles, who had doubts, problems, and fears just like you and I. Jesus interrupted their lives with three words: come follow me. The path he would lead them down would change and impact their lives in a supernatural and profound way. They would become eyewitnesses to God's great power and amazing grace. They would watch him turn water into wine, heal the sick, and raise the dead. You would think that out of all the things that Jesus could do, there wouldn't be any problems following him. But if truth be told, following Jesus can get you crucified. Following Jesus can expose you to all kinds of troubles, inside and also on the outside. In our text this morning, Jesus has been teaching the word of God throughout surrounding cities. His ministry has reached the height of a whole new popularity, and it has caused people to come out with what they had. Many came suffering from serious illnesses. People were bringing sick family members and blind friends, and many that had diseases came also so that he could just speak a word over their life. People came to Jesus because they knew if they got into the presence of the great physician, anything was possible. The reason that you and I are here this morning is because we needed some help. Can I get a witness, somebody? You didn't just show up or come to Jesus just because he had fish fries and he was a wonderful person to hang out with. No. We came to Jesus because we realized it was something wrong with us. Can I get a witness, somebody? You would think that out of all the teaching and preaching he's done throughout the cities, that he and his disciples would have some kind of way taken some time off. But instead of taking time off, he and the 12, the Bible says, entered into a ship. Jesus is a man on the mission, seeking that which is lost. Jesus once said, I must do the work of the Father while it is day. The night cometh when no man could work. Let us go over unto the other side of the lake. He has a passion to continue moving forward. Our God is a progressive God. He's constantly at work. If we're going to follow Jesus, there's no need in getting comfortable. There's always work to do. Can I get a witness, somebody? Let us cross over to the other side. The Bible says that while they were sailing, immediately there comes down a storm. There's nothing like unexpected trouble. There were no signs before they set sail with Jesus that there would be a storm. There was no indications in the sky that a storm was coming. There was no drizzling of rain that a storm was coming. There's nothing like being exposed to unexpected trouble, and we're not spiritually fit to handle it. Can I get a witness, somebody? We just started developing a relationship with Jesus, and now all hell breaks loose. We just moved into this house, and now Jimmy has lost his job. Helen just opened up a bakery, and 3 weeks ago, she finds out she has breast cancer. Jimmy has sent his daughter off to college. She did real good her first semester. Now, all of a sudden, she's been hiding her pregnancy. Trouble breaks out everywhere, and we don't even expect it. There's nothing like being exposed to unexpected trouble. Faith has nowhere to go when things are going well. Our faith has to be challenged in order for us to grow spiritually. There's nothing like a good dose of trouble to show you what you're really working with. Can I get a witness, somebody? We don't have to go looking for trouble. You ain't got to go looking for trouble. Trouble knows your name, your address, your social security number, and it knows what you did last night. Can I get a witness, somebody? And there came down a storm. When most of us set sail with Jesus, things were going well, things were going good. We saw other people going through problems. We saw other people going through setbacks. We saw other people going through breakups. We saw other people just losing their homes, losing their job. And we saw all of that stuff and said, it won't happen to me. We saw drug addicts and alcoholics and homeless people, and we told ourselves, I'd never do that. That'll never happen to me. We saw all of that. We saw people break up who had been together for years and said, I'd never get a divorce. And then all of a sudden, it happened to us. We saw the storms in everybody else's life, but we didn't see the one coming down on us. Can I get a witness, somebody? Yeah. Anytime a sudden storm shows up, it seems that Jesus is nowhere to be found. We soon forget who we're sailing with. We're no match for the storms of life by ourselves. When he said, lo, I am with you always, he meant exactly what he said. There are some storms that bring with it other storms. It's one thing to deal with wind blowing 80 to 100 miles an hour, but it's another for it to stir up a sea. It's the serious disturbance at this point, and one that is violent by nature. The disciples were afraid. They were afraid they would drown. The waves and the wind were beating hard against the ship. In our lives today, we're dealing with all kind of storms. The recent Hurricane Ida, disaster tornadoes, floods, wildfires, difficult children, loss of loved ones, roars of rumors, all type of stuff going on, problems at work, unemployment, broken marriages, health problems, COVID-19, and now they gave it a new name called Delta. All kind of problems. Storms are just popping up everywhere. Everywhere we turn now, there is a storm. But the storm isn't designed to kill us. It's designed to build our hope and our faith in God. Jesus said, let us cross over to the other side. Jesus won't take us through anything that he's not willing to go through himself. Can I get a witness, somebody? He said again, lo, I am with you. And that what he meant, that I'm with you in the fullness of the Spirit. I am omnipresent. I'm everywhere at the same time. I got you covered. Can I get a witness, somebody? And all while the lightning was flashing and the thunder was rolling and the winds were beating down on the ship that it was almost broken, Jesus was down asleep. He got a pillow of sleep. I don't know about nobody else, but when it thunderstormed, I'd go run and jump in the bed. I sleep good during a thunderstorm. That's some of the best sleep I'd get. Matter of fact, I let the window up and let the breeze in. I sleep good during a good thunderstorm. Jesus was sleeping good. You know why? Because he had peace in the middle of the storm. Can I get a witness, somebody? You got to have some peace now. We heard the pastor pray about it this morning. This peace I got, the world didn't give it to me, and the world can't take it away. You can't go to Walmart and buy it for $19.99. You got to get it from Jesus. Can I get a witness, somebody? Only Jesus out of 12 men could find peace in the middle of a storm. God has a peace that will keep our hearts and minds. This is not a good time to lose your mind. Can I get a witness, somebody? Jesus is our Lord and our Savior. We serve a God who will ride through the storms of life with us. If we get in a fight, he'll get right in the middle of it with us. Can I get a witness, somebody? He might not come when you want him to come, but the Bible said that he's always on time. Can I get a witness, somebody? Master, Master, the disciples was cried out, we perished. The Bible said, and he arose. Oh yeah, Jesus is both God and man, divine and human. Jesus was asleep, but the God in him rose up. Can I get a witness, somebody? Oh yes, yes. And he arose and rebuked the wind and the raging sea, and they did cease. Not only did the wind die out, but the raging water lay down and it went to sleep. Can I get a witness, somebody? The winds and waves obeyed the voice of Jesus because they knew that this is the same voice that spoke in the beginning. Let there be light, and it was good. They know that the creator of heaven and earth had spoken. Can I get a witness, somebody? Yeah. Jesus knew that a storm was coming before they got on the boat. Nothing catches God by surprise. It might have knocked the wind out of your sail with all this stuff going on around here now, but it does not catch God by surprise. The Bible said that they sailed into the region. And he sailed on in there, and out of nowhere, here it comes, a naked man. It didn't surprise Jesus at all. A naked man in the cemetery. Can you imagine going down Irving Boulevard? And there's a cemetery that sits right there to your right. Can you imagine just at there you are at your light. And you look over and somebody running through there naked. This was something that the disciples were not prepared for. The Bible says that they set sail to the region of the Gadarene, and as soon as they docked the ship, immediately there met him out of the tombs a man with an unclean spirit. This setting in and of itself is something that you would almost see in a horror movie. In the Gospel of Luke, it is recorded that the man wore no clothes. And nor did he live in a house, but in the tombs. He had been under demonic influence for a long time. And the good shepherd went after a bad lamb. This explains why the storm came down. It was well orchestrated by the devil to prevent Jesus from reaching the man. Satan is the prince and the power of the air. The spirit that is now at work in children of disobedience. Churches today don't like to talk about, teach about, or preach about demonic activity, but it is alive and well. Can I get a witness, somebody? But the early church, all the way down to old storefront, sanctified, Holy Ghost filled, five baptized churches that I grew up in knew how to deal with an unclean spirit. Can I get a witness, somebody? They knew how to discern an unclean spirit when it stepped in the room. I thank God for mama and grandmama and big mama bringing me up in storefront churches where the Holy Ghost fire fell fresh. Can I get a witness, somebody? If they knew you were struggling with a demon, they would bring you down to the altar. And by the time they got through with you, your mouth was foaming. You would pass out a few more times and they'll bring you back through again. They wouldn't stop working on you until it come up out of you. Can I get a witness, somebody? Oh, God, I thank him for the early church. They knew how to call on the name of Jesus. Paul describes Satan first as a prince with power because he has authentic power in the world. 1 John 5:19 teaches us that we know that we are from God, and the whole world lies in the power of the evil one. Satan has a kingdom, and his demons march in harmony. They walk together in lockstep. They are not chaotic nor confused. They are regimented and not divided. They have an order to their destruction. Can I get a witness, somebody? In Matthew's gospel, Jesus said, if Satan drives out Satan, he's divided against himself. How then can his kingdom stand? But if it is by the Spirit of God that I drive out demons, then the kingdom of God has come upon you. Can I get a witness, somebody? The unclean spirit had complete control over the man. Whatever he was struggling with made him not like himself. It caused him to punish himself to the point to where he's now doing bodily harm to himself. The Bible says, and in all ways, night and day, he was in the mountains and in the tombs, crying and cutting himself with stones. The story is further complicated by the fact that no one one in his family could deal with him. The community couldn't deal with him. The police couldn't deal with him. The Army, Navy, Air Force, or Marines couldn't deal with him. Nobody was able to stop this man from hurting himself. They had to watch him kill himself in public. Can I get a witness, somebody? Can I talk about it this morning? Because it's in here today. Can I get a witness, somebody? Have you ever had somebody you love and you had to watch them kill themselves slowly in front of you? You tried everything you could to stop them. You prayed for them. You took them to church. You took them to the hospital. You put them on medication. You called the police to lock them up, and they kept on killing themselves. Can I get a witness, somebody? You tried everything you could think of, but they wouldn't stop crying and cutting themselves with stones. Can I get a witness, somebody? Oh, hallelujah, somebody. No matter how many times these people put him in chains, the spirit that possessed him was so violent that it broke the chains and the shackles. He could break the chains. He could break the shackles. But he couldn't break free from the internal bondage that had him bound. Oh, this is a job for God. Some of us going through some stuff in here this morning, it's a job for God. Some of us been going through some struggles, it's a job for God. Some of us going in the middle of the night, this is a job for God. We've been coming to church because we think that if we come to church and if I just get in the atmosphere, I'll feel all right. But it's only a band-aid to what's really going on the inside. Can I get a witness, somebody? Oh, yeah. An unclean spirit is also a defiant spirit. It doesn't want to be restricted. It doesn't like authority figures, and it hates accountability. It despises rules and regulations, and it, by the way, it's low down and dirty. Oh, can I get a witness, somebody? The man had an unclean spirit. The man was in a mess, living life like a possum, like a rodent, living beneath his God-given potential. He was wild and reckless, living among the dead, sleeping among the dead, eating among the dead. He lived an isolated, lonely life. Satan has a system that's designed to separate us from our help. Oh, can I get a witness, somebody? Yes, yes, some of us here this morning are dealing with an unclean spirit. We're in church. Yes, you're in church. I know you believe in God, but James 2:19 teaches us you believe that there is one God good for you. That even the demons in hell believe and do tremble. Can I get a witness, somebody? Some of us are saved, but we hadn't been delivered yet. We going through some stuff. Oh, you ain't made it to CNN news yet. We hadn't been watching TV and they heard that they had to interrupt this program to bring us a special bulletin. We don't see you in no handcuffs yet, but the people you live with know what you into. Oh, can I get a witness, somebody? Can I preach it like I feel it this morning? Yeah, we've been dealing with some stuff for years, trying to hide it up, cover it up, eat it up, and God longs to heal what we've been hiding. Can I get a witness, somebody? An unclean spirit isn't pretty at all. Oh, it ain't pretty. Yeah, it could be selfishness. It could be arrogancy. It could be pride or prejudice. It could be ego, greed, or gossip. It can be uncontrollable lust, lying and gambling and stealing and jealousy and hatefulness and alcoholism and drug addiction and rebelliousness and even an unteachable spirit. Can I talk about it this morning? In the name of Jesus, that unclean spirit strips some of us. That's why some of us you see that praise God and we thank God every day and we'll run around this church and tear it up because we remember where the Lord brought us from. Oh, can I get a witness, somebody? Some of us that you see praising God, some of us that you see doing work in the community, we just thank God for where he brought us from, because when he found us, we didn't have nothing to hide. We was already naked and not ashamed. Here I am, Lord, come get me. I'm just gonna let it all hang out. I ain't got nothing else to hide. Hallelujah, somebody. You might as well quit covering up and just run to him naked while you still got a chance. Can I get a witness, somebody? Oh, yeah, yeah, we didn't have nothing to hide, baby. We was naked and we were not ashamed. The Lord has been good to us. That's why we don't let no slit in our wrist, because nobody went to the club, because I didn't get a like on Facebook. I got peace in God. Can I get a witness, somebody? Jesus said the thief comes to steal, kill, and destroy. I have come that they may have life and have a bit more abundantly. Oh, can I get a witness? Some of us in here right now, we won't let nobody know how the abundance look in our life. If we let you know how the abundance look, you'll want to run us over in the parking lot. Oh, God has been good to some of us. We're walking into a whole nother level, a whole nother realm of blessing, because we've stepped into the abundance. Can I get a witness, somebody? Oh, hallelujah, somebody. Yeah, 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 yeah. He stepped into, Jesus said, I want you to have life, and I want to give it to you more abundantly. When? Back in the sweet by and by? No, in the nasty now and now. I want you to be blessed. I want every devil in hell to know I bless you. You can't cover up the light of life I have put in your life. Can I get a witness, somebody? Oh, yeah, 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 yeah. You can't cover it up. My anointing is too strong on your life. You can't hide it. You can only divide it. Share with somebody. Love on somebody. Give something back to somebody so that I can open up the windows of heaven and pour you out a blessing that you ain't got room enough to receive. Can I get a witness, somebody? Oh, yeah, 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 yeah. Now, this man no doubt had a home and a family, but the demonic influence he was under drove him away from his families and friends and into a graveyard where he would live. How did he get there? How did he get there? How did I get there? I had a home, a loving home, a loving family, beautiful grandmother, beautiful cousins in childhood. How did I end up on Lake and Cicero? How in the world did I end up way out there? And my family would pull up every now and then. There I was, homeless. How, when he got all of these family and friends that love, what was it that's driving? How did Derrick get there? And grandmama would have tears streaming down her face, and she would bring me a plate. You know them aluminum pans? She didn't come with no plate. She had them aluminum pans, and the food was hot. And as soon as it hit my hand, it was scorching me half to death. And she have a little foil on it. She said, baby, eat that. Trying to help keep me alive. This man got there for some reason. Understand where we are in the world today. Begins the process of realizing the devil's tactics, and that is to isolate us from our help. The lust of the flesh, the lust of the eye, and the pride of life, that's all that's in the world. The devil doesn't use any tricks or scam. He uses our reality against us, like he did the COVID pandemic. He used it as a spiritual attack to pull us away from our source of support system, which is the local church, which could have liberated us. Can I get a witness, somebody? And now we have people that we love, people in the church family, people all over the United States. A stronghold took them on the reason of COVID, and we don't even see them no more, and don't know if they gonna ever make it back to church. Can I get a witness, somebody? The enemy used it as a spiritual attack on the church. Can I get a witness, somebody? The Bible says when the man saw Jesus afar off, he ran and worshiped him. This was the man's help. Can I get a witness, somebody? Jesus is the only one that can break demonic influences and strongholds off of our life. Can I get a witness, somebody? Some of us have been dealing with it for far too long, but our help has showed up. up this morning. Can I get a witness, somebody? When the man saw Jesus, he saw his opportunity. The Bible says, and the man took off and he started running. Can I get a witness, somebody? He didn't tiptoe to Jesus. He didn't do the electric slide to Jesus. He didn't do the moonwalk. He ran. Can I get a witness, somebody? The reason some of us don't get a breakthrough is because we won't run. We won't run. We want to lay back. We want to chill. You got to run to Jesus. If you knew that thing you struggling with was trying to kill you, you would run to Jesus while you still had a chance. Can I get a witness, somebody? Yeah, a lot of us are struggling with guilt and shame and remorse and unforgiveness and past failures. We're dealing with all kind of stuff. The Bible says that when the man ran to Jesus, the unclean spirit started running too. Does your unclean spirit follow you? Oh, does it follow you? We all got something unclean we're dealing with it here this morning, and we wish it would just go away. While the man was worshiping Jesus, the unclean spirit started talking to Jesus. Have you ever felt like you was at least two people instead of one? Oh, can I talk about it this morning? While you were praying, the other voice started talking. You trying to pray to God, and the other voice said, did you lock that back door? You sure you turned that stove off? The train and them turned that TV off. I wonder what they do. What's that out front going on? Oh, it's trying to disturb you and distract you from what God would have you to do. Can I get a witness, somebody? Oh, it'll attack later. I don't care if the dog got loose or not. I don't care if the light on in the kitchen. I'm going to stay right here in prayer. Can I get a witness, somebody? Oh, yeah, the unclean spirit has a nature of its own, and it will talk to us without our permission. Can I get a witness, somebody? The unclean spirit began to question Jesus' presence, his name. He asked Jesus, he said, what do you want with me? He was aware of who Jesus was. It knew his power. It knew his presence. When you and I walk into a room, people ought to see the presence of God. Can I get a witness, somebody? When you walk up in a room, people ought to see the divine glory of God on your life. Can I get a witness, somebody? They need to know if some help has made it. Can I get a witness, somebody? Yeah, it cried, what do you want with me, Jesus? Son of the Most High God, he said, I beg you, torture me not. Jesus asked the unclean spirit, what's your name? The spirit called itself Legion, meaning many. The word itself was common in the Roman Empire. It was used to describe the largest single military unit in the Roman army, which would have been about 6,000 soldiers. This man had 6,000 demons living inside of him. They were regimented. They had an order. They spoke with one voice. They were many, but yet they spoke with one voice. They were unique. They worked together in their unit. They were combative. They were aggressive, and they were dangerous. Can I get a witness, somebody? Somebody in here this morning. Yeah, we're looking good. We're smelling good. We got on pretty dresses and hats and hair made up. But some of us in here are combative. We're aggressive and can be dangerous. Can I get a witness, somebody? And Jesus wants to know, what is your name? Because we know you by somebody else. And God is wanting to know, what's that down inside of you? That is stirring up stuff that won't let you get no rest at night. That got you going and you don't want to go. That's got you doing things that you don't want to do. What is your name? Can I get a witness, somebody? Oh, we toughen until God start asking us questions. Oh, yes. What is your name? When the Lord asks us a question, it's not that he's asking us something that he doesn't know, because he knows all things. When the Lord is asking us a question, he's doing it to reveal something to us. There's something he wants to work out of us. Can I get a witness, somebody? The unclean spirit began to negotiate its exit. Jesus cast the spirit out of the man and sent it in some pigs that were feeding nearby. Gadarenes was a country. And they raised pigs. Yes, yes, yes. It was going to be a pork chop shortage. Oh, when Jesus got there, they won't be smoking any ribs. There wasn't going to be no pig feet and pig ears or pork chops. It had to leave today. Can I get a witness, somebody? The Bible said, and as soon as the unclean spirit entered the pigs, it ran violently down the hill and they drowned in the sea. One of the things that bothered me was, if the unclean spirit killed a herd of about 2,000 pigs, why couldn't it kill one man? Because help was on the way. God kept the man alive long enough for Jesus to meet him. Oh, it was a divine appointment. Some of us in here right now, we don't know why we still here, but God kept us alive long enough until we met Jesus. Can I get a witness, somebody? My life don't make sense. Ain't nowhere in the world I should be alive. But when I look back over my shoulder and see where the Lord brought me from, I got to give him the praise. Can I get a witness, somebody? The man was there. The storm was a distraction, but it couldn't stop Jesus from saving me. The storms have been a distraction, but it couldn't stop Jesus from saving you. Jesus could have avoided the situation, but I heard him say, "For the Son of Man came to seek and save those that are lost." I am the good shepherd, and I lay down my life for the sheep. Can I get a witness, somebody? The only way a man, a woman, a boy, or a girl can break free of the thing that's holding them back, they got to get to Jesus while they still have a chance. This man was set free. He received a breakthrough mentally, physically, and spiritually. Can I get a witness, somebody? He wanted to go with Jesus, but Jesus told him, he said, no. He said, go home. One thing that sins does, it'll drive you out of your own house. You there, but you not there. Just ask the person sitting next to you. You're here 1 minute, but you're gone the next. Your body with me, but your mind on the other side of town. Can I get a witness, somebody? He said, I want you to go home. Jesus told him to go home to your family and your friends and tell them the great things that the Lord has done for you. In other words, go and testify. Can I get a witness, somebody? Go and share your story and tell them about the good thing that the Lord has done for you. Even as the Son of Man came, not to be ministered unto, but to be give his life for a ransom. Now that I've saved you, now that I've sanctified you, go and tell somebody the good news of what the Lord has done for you. Put your hands together and give the Lord and give him a hand clap of praise. You don't have to die in a cemetery. You don't have to continue to cut yourself with memories of the past and who left and who stayed. Some people go over stuff that happened 10, 15, and 20 years ago. So and so left me. And then people was going on with their life. And I'm still living in the past of sad memories. God wants to save us. God wants to save us. Father God, in the name of Jesus, Lord, consecrate this place. Lord, I thank you. I thank you for the challenge. I thank you for challenging me, Lord, and helping me to see where we are in the world today. And part of what's taking place You've allowed the prince and power of the air to move to and fro. He can't do nothing without you. We forget that he shows up at board meetings. That when the sons of men show up, he's there too. Oh God, in the name of Jesus, help us, Lord God, in the name of Jesus, receive a divine spirit of discernment in these last and evil days. And for those of us that you have saved and sanctified and prepared for this work, this is an exciting time for us. I thank you that you let me set sail with you. You've taken me some places I never dreamed of. I thank you for shaking me up sometime, turning me around, putting my hands on things and you break my grip. I thank you for raising me. You're still raising me. Thank you, Lord, today. Prepare your church right now. Oh, we've danced, we've shouted, but it's work to do now. Trouble is everywhere. We're now living in the last days. And we ought to be excited about it, because you're on your way back. Prepare us to be of service to those that are in need. And those things that we're struggling with, Lord, we ask in the name of Jesus that we surrender our pain, we surrender our heartache, we surrender our disappointments, whatever addictions it might be. Lord, you're able to break it in the name of Jesus. You're able to restore marriages in the name of Jesus. You're able to restore finances in the name of Jesus. Lord, whatever situation we're going through, you're able to do it. But we got to surrender to you. We got to give you our will. And we got to give you our life. Lord, in the name of Jesus, move upon the church. Move upon the body of believers. Oh God, save us. Save that man in here this morning. Save that woman in here this morning. Save that one in here this morning that then canceled another doctor's appointment. Don't want to hear what he said. I'm going to pray about it, Lord. I want to go to the doctor again. Lord, I pray in the name of Jesus that you would give them peace right now. Those that have lost loved ones, every now and then I think about my mom and I just drift away. I pray, Lord, that in those moments you would comfort those of us who've lost people that have been precious to us. Sometimes we'll sink into a depression and we won't even tell nobody about it. There are times we wish, Lord God, that we could go on and be with you. But you let us be still for a minute, because you still got work for us to do. And so, Lord, we want to say thank you. We want to say thank you. You remember when we first took our first steps as little girls and little boys. You've watched us when we woke up in the morning and went to school. You've been with us through every twist and every turn in life. You've been good to us, oh God. You've been better to us than we've been to ourselves. And now, despite the storm raging, you're still with us. You promised never to leave us nor forsake us. And we want to say thank you. 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 If we had 1,000 tongues, we couldn't thank you enough. Thank you. 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 Hallelujah. For coming to see about me. I thought I would make it, but help was on the way. Give your God a praise. Thank you.